Hello, best friends. How are you going? Thank you so much for joining me back in our safe little space of the internet. I've missed you. You are looking so beautiful today, and I'm so excited to be hanging out with you again. Now that it's finally December, welcome officially to the Christmas season. You are now free to blare that Mariah Carey Christmas music with zero shame and not have to hide it from your friends and family and co-workers like you have for the last 3 months. That's just me. Okay. Cool. Also, yes, you're not seeing things. My hair has changed. Long story short, I was like, yeah, I could go and get my roots done finally, or I could avoid all of that awkward small talk at the hairdressers that just gives me massive anxiety and just do my hair at home. And so I went and picked up a box of what I thought was a nice gingery red, and this is the end result. But I don't hate it. I'm not mad at it. We are making it work. Everything is fine. It's fine. If you've never been here before, then hi, hello, my name is Liz, and I am so glad that you randomly stumbled across this video. Don't you think it would just be so much fun if you like subscribed and we hung out and got to know each other and we're best friends forever and ever? Because it sure sounds like fun to me. As usual, today we are joined by our other best friend, our emotional support princess, Lily, who is here to introduce some visual and audio disturbances in today's video and also just a little bit of joy and sunshine into all of our lives because she's an earth angel in the form of a canine. So today we're going to be talking about a beautiful young woman named Shani Warren, who had her life cruelly snatched away from her 34 years ago in 1987. Shani's case first came to my attention a couple of months ago because of some well overdue current day updates that we're going to be talking about later in this video, but I started looking into it and it's tragic and it's infuriating, it's mysterious, and it kind of just sucked me right in. And I'm going to be really interested to hear what you guys think when we're done. So it was dusk on Easter Sunday, the 18th of April, 1987, at about 6:30 p.m. when a woman named Marjorie Arnold was out walking her German Shepherd around Taplow Lake, which is a huge lake located in the affluent area of Buckinghamshire. It's a really popular spot for water sports. It's surrounded by mansions. It just looks really beautiful. So Marjorie and her dog, I'm not sure what this dog's name was, but every dog deserves a name. So let's call him Benji. Marjorie and Benji were taking a peaceful early evening stroll around the lake when all of a sudden, Benji started pulling on the lead, trying to pull Marjorie off the path towards the lake itself. And Marjorie was like, no, Benji, we're walking this way, the way we always go. But Benji just would not give up. He was really interested in something in the lake. So eventually Marjorie was like, fine, and walked over the muddy bank with him to the lake and was just filled with complete horror when she realized what Benji had been trying to alert her to, because lying face down in the lake in just about 3 feet of water was the body of 26-year-old Shani Warren. Marjorie, in a complete state of panic, not knowing quite what to do, quickly ran up the bank to the side of the busy A4, a major road close by, and flagged down a motorist, and together they went back to the lake and pulled Shani out of the water. When they realized it was too late to attempt any kind of resuscitation, Marjorie stayed with Shani's body while the motorists went to find a phone and call the police, who arrived on the scene shortly after. It only took one look at Shani to realize that her last moments had been filled with absolute terror. Her hands had been tied behind her back with a jump lead, and her legs had been tied together with a tow rope. She had also been gagged with a blue scarf, and there was a dark ligature mark around her neck that would later be determined to have been created by a jump lead found in the lake matching the one tied around her wrists. These jump leads and the tow rope had came from Shani's own prized black Vauxhall Cavalier, which was found parked in a lay-by or rest area by the A4. And at her autopsy, it would be revealed that she had been sexually assaulted before she died. You know, everything clearly pointed to Shani being the victim of a very brutal, vicious attack. And yet, just a day or two after her body was discovered, one of the officers involved in the investigation into her death would make a statement to the public that the police believed that Shani, overcome with severe depression, had taken her own life. Yeah, they believed that Shani had gagged herself, tied herself up, and hopped from her car down to the lake to drown herself in 3 feet of water. Oh, hi. I don't know what they were thinking. Do you? It doesn't make any sense, does it? But before we get any further into the investigation, let's rewind a little and get to know who Shani was. Shani Warren was the youngest of three children born to Joe and Eloise Warren, and the Warrens were quite a wealthy family. I'm not sure what Joe did for a living, but by 1987, the year of the murder, he was a work-from-home millionaire. The Warrens were a really close-knit family, and Joe and Eloise looked after Shani and her two older brothers really well, and the three of them were very fortunate enough to be nicely set up in life. Shani, for instance, had a nice, modest house that her parents had been kind enough to buy for her. But from what people had to say about Shani, it seems like she was this really down-to-earth, independent woman who was determined to make it on her own and not just rely on handouts from her parents. And so she shared her house with two housemates, and she worked as a secretary at a company called Microscope. This was a job that she made no secret of hating, and she actually told a few people that she was keen to leave and find something else, but she was still determined to work, you know, and she was doing really well for herself. She had recently just paid off her brand new shiny black Vauxhall Cavalier, and this was an achievement she was really proud of. Shani was a beautiful, really friendly girl, so it's a pretty safe bet that she had a lot of admirers. But on Thursday, the 16th of April, the day before her life would meet its tragic end, she decided to reach out to an old flame, her ex-boyfriend Roger Pell. The two of them hadn't been in contact for months, but Shani randomly gave him a call and invited him out to dinner. And so they went out and they had a really lovely time. Roger said that Shani didn't seem depressed at all. Instead, she seemed really happy and relaxed. And when the night ended, they had agreed to see each other again, sometime soon, maybe even that weekend, so that they could celebrate Easter together. The next morning on Good Friday, even though she'd been out late enjoying herself with Roger the night before, Shani was up bright and early because she had big plans for the day. The suburb she lived in, Stoke Poges, was a really nice area, and all of her neighbors kept their lawns and their yards meticulously neat. Whereas for Shani, gardening hadn't ever really been that high on her priority list, and like, same, gardening is the worst, but Shani was determined to mend her ways. So she hopped in her car and drove the 10 minutes from her house to her parents' house in Gerrard Cross to pick up an extension cord for her electric lawnmower. While she was there, she spoke briefly with her dad, Joe, about the family's plans to meet up for Easter Sunday lunch in the seaside town of Bournemouth, where her mum, Eloise, was already staying. And they worked out the travel logistics, deciding that Joe would come to Shani's house and pick her up, and they would drive together. Shani said goodbye and gave her dad a kiss on the cheek before she drove back home and started mowing her lawn. And either she really had just kind of let it get completely out of control, or it was a very big lawn, because by the time she finished at around 4 p.m., she had 6 huge big bin liners just filled to the brim with grass clippings. For a while after this, Shani just kind of chilled out and recovered for a while. She hung out with her two housemates, Katie and Fiona. And Fiona said that Shani didn't really seem to have any firm plans for the night. At 6 p.m., Shani started loading the bags of grass into the boot of her car, and she took off from the house not long after, roughly at about 6.05 p.m. But despite having told Katie and Fiona earlier that she was planning on taking the grass clippings to her parents' house because they had a compost heap in their backyard, For some reason that isn't known to anyone, Shani turned and drove in the opposite direction of her parents' house. This would prove to be the last confirmed time that Shani would ever be seen alive. And tragically, just seconds after she pulled out of the driveway, her mum, Eloise Warren, called to speak with her on the home phone, but she would never get to speak with her daughter again. Shani's body was discovered in Taplow Lake just a short 24 hours after she had pulled out of her driveway. And as I mentioned earlier, her car was found in the lay-by or rest area close to the lake, just off the A4. And there were definitely some things worth noting. Firstly, one of the doors had been left slightly ajar and the driver's seat had been pushed all the way back in the reclined position. Inside the car, in the front passenger footwell, was Shani's watch and the 6 bin liners that had been filled with grass clippings, but they were now empty. Also in the car was Shani's lighter on the front passenger seat, and on the floor in the rear of the car was a blank card, envelope, and bottle of champagne. And in the front, under the steering wheel, was an Easter egg that Shani's friends would later say she had bought for Roger Pell. Despite a thorough search of the area, police never ended up finding Shani's car keys, but scattered around the car on the ground, they found her credit card holder, her tow rope bag, and a thank you note she had written to Roger for the dinner they had shared on Thursday. So we don't know where Roger lived, but is it possible, considering the Easter egg and the thank you note, that Shani had been on her way to see him, and on the way, she had stopped at the lake to empty the bags of grass clippings? But then surely this meeting, you know, this rekindled flame would be something she would have been excited about and told her housemates about. So why were they under the impression that Shani didn't really have any plans for the evening? Things got more interesting when police went to move Shani's car and found that they couldn't. The car, this near brand new car, had a problem with the gearbox where it would not move in first or second gear, making it near impossible to get it moving from a stationary position. So was this maybe why Shani had pulled over into the lay-by near the lake? And maybe in a cruel twist of fate, she had met with foul play while she was stranded there? Yeah, it really doesn't seem like police ever ask themselves these questions, because as we know, despite Shani being found gagged and with her hands tied behind her back, they made that baffling statement to the public very early on that they believed she had ended her own life. So what on God's green earth were they basing this theory on? It's pretty embarrassing, if I'm honest. At the crime scene, investigators had found that other than Shani's stiletto heel prints, there were no other footprints visible in the soft ground near the lake. And this is what led to their conclusion that Shani had been on her own when she went into the lake. Show of hands if you've worn stilettos before and are wishing like hell you had been on that crime scene to tell those investigators that those narrow little needle-like heels of death will sink into any remotely soft ground like it's quicksand and will most definitely leave imprints where flat shoes never would. I'm not sure if these investigators passed on their suspicions to Dr. Ben Davis, who was the pathologist that performed Shani's original post-mortem examination, or not, but it just seems like they did, because he also ruled Shani's death to be a suicide based on him finding no evidence of a struggle on Shani's body. Luckily, though, another full-blown postmortem was performed by a different pathologist who noted the ligature mark around Shani's neck, as well as bruises on both of her thighs and the back of one of her hands, and evidence that a sexual assault had taken place. Shani's cause of death was officially recorded as drowning, but it wasn't until a not expert advised the police that there was no way that Shani had bound herself with the knots used to tie her hands behind her back that a murder investigation was finally launched. By now, 3 days had passed, meaning that 72 precious hours had been wasted, and any trail that Shani's killer may have left might already have gone cold.
Hi. I know. It's gotten worse. So much worse. Right? What were they thinking? Hey, just bear with me. Okay.
On Thursday, the 23rd of April, 1 week after her murder, Shani's case was featured on BBC's Crime Watch, and The lead investigator had the nerve to sit down on camera and tell the public that they had treated Shani's case as a murder investigation from the get-go. He also said that there was no clear motive because there had been no money that had been stolen and Shani's car had been left at the crime scene. And he went through a couple of the tips and sightings that had already come in from the public. At 6:50 p.m. on Good Friday, so just under an hour after Shani left her home, someone reported seeing a black car that seemed to be in difficulty on the A4 just outside of Maidenhead, so very close to Taplow Lake, and multiple people had seen Shani's car parked in the lay-by between Good Friday evening and when her body had been found on Easter Saturday. One of these people was one of the many truck drivers that used the lay-by as a place to park his truck overnight. This truck driver named Donald Ward had pulled into the lay-by at about 1:30 a.m. on the night of Easter Saturday, and he had seen Shani's car parked there with the door slightly ajar, but he knew that this lay-by was also frequented by a lot of couples as a quiet, secluded place to make out and so on. So he kind of just rolled his eyes and drove past and parked his truck and went home. When he came back the following morning, Shani's car was still there, but he just figured it must have broken down and that the owner must have had a recovery vehicle called out. The car was seen there again at 1:30 p.m. by two horse riders who also noticed that the door was open, but they didn't think much of it until news broke of Shani's murder. It seems like these had been the only tips that had come in from the public up until this point before the Crime Watch episode aired, but from these tips, although Shani's time of death was never able to be confirmed by forensic testing, it was assumed that she had died on the evening of Good Friday, within a couple of hours of when she had left her home. So that night on the show, police put out a call for people to come forward with anything they had seen from around 6 p.m. Good Friday onwards. You know, anyone acting suspiciously in the area or cars pulling in and out of the lay-by. And during the show, and in the few days following, a number of people did call in. One woman said that she had been walking with her daughter close to the spot where Shani's car had been parked, and they had seen a blonde woman matching Shani's description standing on a grass verge close to the lake holding what looked to be a black bin liner. And the woman said that as they had walked past, her daughter had called out hello to Shani, and Shani, if it was her, had smiled and waved back at the little girl. The AA, which is like a large breakdown service in Britain, also confirmed that they had been called out to assist a woman who had broken down in that same area on the exact same road, but this was later found to be a false lead. The sighting that police were most interested in was one that had been called in by multiple different people who all said that they had seen a blonde woman standing on the side of the road, standing by a black vehicle which matched the description of Shani's car. And the bonnet of this car had been open and there had been three men, all with their heads in there looking at the engine. But even though the police put out another call specifically for any information regarding these three men, this lead eventually fizzled out and didn't progress the investigation any further. In fact, the investigation, which was very aptly described by one reporter as puzzlingly unenthusiastic, was not really progressing at all. And 6 months later in October, when an inquest was held into Shani's death, police hadn't really made any major developments in the case. They were still convinced that Shani had been murdered and had gone to the effort of having a forensic pathologist named Dr. John Hamilton examine Shani's diaries and visit Taplow Lake. And Dr. Hamilton testified at the inquest that if there was any indication of a serious abnormality, I would expect to find it in those diaries. I found no trace of that. There was nothing in the diaries to indicate that she had any serious disorder, such as depressive illness, serious personality disorder, or schizophrenia. She appears to have been a healthy young girl. It is rare for a person to disguise suicide as murder. A reconstruction by the police had also shown that it would have been near impossible for Shani to get from her car to the lake by herself with her hands tied behind her back and her legs bound together. Shani's parents and her brother Stephen also testified at the inquest, saying that they believed there was no way that Shani would have taken her own life. Shani's parents, Joe and Eloise, even went so far as to request a video taken of Shani's body during her autopsy be shown at the inquest, and they themselves couldn't even sit in the courtroom while it was being shown. But their reasoning was that anyone that saw Shani's injuries for themselves in this video would not be able to believe that she had taken her own life. But Dr. Ben Davis, the pathologist who performed Shani's original autopsy, said he still believed that Shani had committed suicide. In fact, he said he had handled no less than 3 other cases recently where people had gagged themselves before drowning themselves. Speaking of Mr. Davis, he had actually been removed from the Home Office's approved list of pathologists, and he had only recently been reinstated when he performed Shani's autopsy. But, like, that's just an irrelevant little side note. In the end, the coroner felt that there was too much conflicting evidence to rule Shani's death a murder and instead recorded an open verdict, which is kind of the last resort where the coroner or the jury feels that, yes, the death was suspicious, but there's just not enough evidence to prove either way whether that death was murder or suicide. And this ruling of an open verdict essentially closed the case for decades. But there were theories floating around, and it's those theories that we're going to address now. Firstly, let's talk the suicide theory and just kind of knock that one off the table right now. Those close to the case, like Shani's family and the police, were convinced that she hadn't committed suicide. And even from an outsider's perspective, it just didn't really make any sense. Shani had made plans for the immediate future with both her family and Roger. She had spent the day mowing the lawn. She had a bottle of champagne and a thank you note in the car. None of these things pointed at Shani planning on driving to Taplow Lake, tying herself up and ending her own life by strangling herself. And then when that didn't work out, instead deciding to drown herself in 3 feet of water. Like, looking at it this way, it's just kind of mind-boggling to think that the coroner at Shani's inquest recorded an open verdict at all. And this leads us to a couple of dozen deaths in the years surrounding Shani's, where the overwhelming majority of them were also given an open verdict. In 1985, a couple of years before Shani died, Jonathan Wash was found dead on the pavement outside the hotel he was staying at in West Africa. The general assumption was that this was a terrible accident and that Jonathan must have fallen from his balcony, but his family and friends said that for weeks leading up to his death, Jonathan had been extremely paranoid and told them that he felt he was being watched. The following year, in 1986, 24-year-old Vimal Dudgeon told his wife that he was going to be home late. He then drove for 100 miles away from his home in Middlesex to jump to his death from a bridge in Bristol. Police believed that he had been drunk and depressed, but his family claimed that he wasn't suffering from depression and never drank. Also, his body was found with his trousers around his ankles, and there was a strange puncture mark found during his autopsy on his buttock that could not be explained by the fall. Just a couple of months later, 26-year-old Arshad Sharif also drove to Bristol, where he checked into a guest house using money from a large wad of cash he had in his possession before he took a rope and tied one end to a tree and the other around his neck. He then got in his car and slammed down the accelerator, nearly decapitating himself and obviously dying in the process. The coroner in Ashad's case ruled his death to be a suicide, but a relative who saw the car after the accident said that he saw a metal pole lying on the floor of the car by the accelerator pedal and believed that it had been used to force the pedal down. And the list just goes on. In March of 1987, David Sands loaded up his car with cans of petrol, and while he was on his way to work, he pulled a sudden U-turn and drove at high speeds into an empty restaurant and died in the resulting explosion. The following month, just days before Shani died and just minutes from where her body would be found, David Greenhalgh jumped off a railway bridge on his way to work. He ended up landing on some soft grass and actually survived for a few days after the fall. And while he was in hospital, when he was asked, he just said he had no idea why he had jumped. Like, He had no explanation before he eventually died from the injuries he had sustained. The very same day that Shani died, George Countess drove for over 3,000 miles and was found drowned in his car in River Mersey in Liverpool. And in August the following year, both 50-year-old Alistair Beckham and 60-year-old Peter Ferry were both found dead in their homes, having taken their own lives by electrocuting themselves using electrical wires and leads that they had jammed into power sockets. This is only a handful of a list of 25 people who all died under some strange to outright bizarre circumstances, but why am I talking about them and how are they all connected? The first thing worth noting is that only two of these 25 deaths were officially ruled as suicide, because just like Shani's death, in most of these cases, suicide just did not fit the bill. None of them had a history of depression or mental illness, and most of them spent their time performing their usual day-to-day tasks as usual before dying under these really weird circumstances. The big connection here, though, is that all 25 of these people were scientists and engineers involved with the same high-tech electronics company called GEC Marconi. And this group of deaths is commonly known as the GEC Marconi Scientist Deaths Conspiracy Theory. In the 1980s, GEC Marconi happened to be the UK's only supplier of torpedoes, and they were working on a number of different top secret weapons programs for both the UK and US governments, including one of President Ronald Reagan's pet projects, the Strategic Defense Initiative, better known as Project Star Wars, the aim of which was to develop a system that could intercept Russian missiles from space. It was pretty wild. And those that believe this conspiracy theory say that all of these scientists and engineers were killed as some part of espionage activity because of their involvement in these products. It's said that before they died, a lot of these people said something similar to what Jonathan Wash had told his family, that they felt they were being watched or followed. Some of them claimed that they had uncovered a big secret at work, and at least three of them had arranged meetings with their member of parliament to discuss serious matters, but all of them died before the meetings could take place. I know, how on earth does Shani tie into all of this? Well, 4 weeks before she died, the company she worked for, Microscope, was bought over by none other than GEC Marconi, of course, leading her death to be lumped in with this conspiracy theory, which was detailed in a book released in 1992 called Open Verdict. Part of this conspiracy theory was that there was a huge top secret cover-up involved. And when it came to Shani's case, people speculated that Dr. Ben Davis, the pathologist that insistently claimed that she had committed suicide, was in on it. Now, judge me all you want, but I will freely admit I love a good conspiracy theory. Like, not that kind. The good old-fashioned kind. Like, did we really land on the moon? Is Elvis still alive? Are we all just living in one big computer simulation? I cannot get enough. But the problem with these theories is that things get dramatized. People like to put their own twists on things. It becomes very difficult to tell fact from fiction. And while this is a very bizarre connection, it's hard to place a lot of weight on this idea that Shani was killed because of her job as a secretary at a company just recently acquired by GEC Marconi. And so rather than this conspiracy theory, the most widely accepted theory over the years was that Shani had actually been a victim of a man named Clive Barwell. Clive Barwell was a serial rapist who spent 16 years traveling the country, committing his crimes before he was finally arrested in March of 1998. He pled guilty to 3 rapes, 1 attempted murder, 4 kidnappings, 1 serious sexual assault, 1 indecent sexual assault, and 1 assault occasioning actual bodily harm. And he was given 8 life sentences. And the things that Barwell's victims went through, they were horrendous, they were horrific, but I want to focus on the way the police and just the justice system in general handled the cases of these women. Firstly, after his first 2 victims in 1982 reported their attacks to the authorities, the police quickly realized that the crimes were related, and there were body hairs found, there were swabs taken, there was evidence found in both of their cars. Like, investigators had good stuff to go on. But within months of not finding their perpetrator, police threw in the towel, destroyed the evidence, and just stopped looking, even though they knew there was a potentially serial rapist on the loose. And so over the years that followed, Barwell was able to go on and abduct and assault multiple other women. Some of these attacks taking place while he was technically in prison, because in January 1989, Barwell was sentenced to 16 years jail time for armed robbery. But after 3.5 years of being a model prisoner, he was downgraded to the lowest possible security status, meaning he was allowed 4 days leave to go and visit his sick father, during which time he brutally attacked another one of his victims. During this same prison sentence, he also remarried and worked as a hotel manager with his new wife in Ashburn, and he was allowed to stay at this hotel quite often, up to 3 nights at a time, and earn a salary of roughly £10,000 a year. And it's believed he was involved in a number of other unsolved rapes that occurred in the area surrounding the hotel he was working at. And that was the main problem. Barwell was committing these terrible attacks all over the place, meaning the crimes were being investigated by different police departments who, it seems like, just refused to communicate or cooperate with each other. Like, honestly, when a detective inspector from Notts finally found a connection and contacted the West York detectives to tell them that he thought he had a case that was related to one of theirs, their alleged response was to tell him to fuck off. It wasn't until 1995 when Barwell, who had only served, if you could call it that, 7 years of his 16-year sentence, was released from prison and just 5 weeks later went on to attempt to assault another woman, that police finally joined forces and made a break in the case. During this attack, Barwell used a tube of super glue he found in the victim's car to glue her eyes shut. But when she fought back, he accidentally cut himself, leaving a trace of his blood in her car. And he also left a fingerprint while rifling through her bag. And it was these crucial pieces of evidence that finally, after a huge, very celebrated investigation called Operation Lynx, resulted in him being arrested and placed behind bars for 8 life sentences. And everything in me wishes I could leave it there, but one of the things I learned about the Barwell case is that the handling of it went beyond incompetence. It was revealed after Barwell was finally arrested that one of the police officers involved in the investigation was using the case file photos of one of the victims that showed her body and her injuries as illicit material for his own pleasure. And this officer actually went to this woman's house and tried to have sex with her. Don't worry though, that guy was fired and jailed for a totally separate, quote, unrelated indecency. Back to Shani though, when one of the detectives on the Operation Lynx task force was looking at Barwell's movements as a long distance truck driver over the years, he picked up that around the time of Shani's murder, Barwell had been delivering car parts in an area less than an hour's drive away from Taplow Lake. And even though Barwell claimed he had nothing to do with Shani's murder, and as far as police knew, he had never killed any of his other victims, there were definitely some things that pointed at him being involved. For instance, the knots that Shani had been tied up with were knots regularly used by truck drivers, and Barwell did have a habit of tying up his victims. He tended to also use things in his attacks that he found in the victim's own cars, and Shani had been tied up with her own jump leads and tow rope. Then there was also the fact that Shani's car had been found in a lay-by that was often used as a truck stop. So had Shani maybe pulled into the lay-by when she was experiencing car issues at the same time that Barwell was there parking his truck? Police already suspected that Barwell was guilty of way more crimes than he was admitting to. So Shani's case, it went unsolved for years and years, but the general consensus of the public and the police was that she had been one of Barwell's victims. That is until June this year, over 3 decades after Shani was murdered, when the first arrest in connection with her case was made. And it wasn't Clive Barwell, who is still behind bars serving his 8 life sentences. Thank God. got. So it turns out that Shani's case had been reopened on the down low and was reinvestigated by the Thames Valley Police Major Crime Review Team. And whatever they found led them to arrest a 66-year-old man named Donald Robertson, who is an old age pensioner from Slough. And Robertson has subsequently been charged with the murder, indecent assault, and false imprisonment of Shani Warren, as well as the rape and kidnap of a 16-year-old girl from Slough in 1981. At the time of Robertson's arrest, Shani's aunt made a statement to the press saying that sadly, both Joe and Eloise had passed away earlier this year during the pandemic. So they both died never knowing who had killed their daughter or seeing any justice served for her. Robertson was supposed to appear in court a few days ago for a pre-trial hearing, but he refused to leave his jail cell, telling the judge via video link that he was in isolation due to his health and a COVID outbreak at the prison. His trial is set to commence in April next year, and for now, that's where this case stands as of today. But let's debrief just quickly and talk about our feelings a little bit, because I don't know about you guys, but I need that. Firstly, I'm so happy that after all of this time, Shani will hopefully finally get some justice. And I think all of us can agree that it has just taken way too long. I'm feeling a little frustrated because it's still such early days after Robertson's arrest and there's just not a whole lot of information available, including what finally led to his arrest. Like so many other cold cases getting solved today after so many years, I can only assume that it's DNA evidence, and I'm sure we'll find out more in the months to come. But seeing as this man has already been connected to at least one other assault, I do wonder if there's going to be more victims that come up who have also gone without justice for way too long. I also wonder about the sighting reported by multiple people about those three men staring under the bonnet of that black car and where that falls into all of this. If Donald Robertson was maybe one of those men, or if maybe it wasn't Shani's car at all and it's totally unrelated. Did anyone else immediately suspect Shani's ex, Roger Pell, who she had dinner with the night before she died? Because same. But even before Robertson was arrested, Roger wasn't really mentioned in any of the other info about the case. So, like, I assume he was looked into and ruled out as a suspect, but with how police handled this case, who knows? I honestly feel like I could go mad just thinking about it. But as usual, I would love to hear your guys' thoughts on this case. This hangout does not have to end here. We can just shuffle on down to the comments below. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, you can let me know by giving it a thumbs up. If you haven't already, you should totally take the plunge and subscribe so that we can be the bestest of friends that there ever was. And if we are already best friends and you want to hang out even more than we do here, you can always follow me over on Instagram and get a bit more of a personal look at what I do with my life outside of this little box on your screen. And there's lots of photos of Lily as well, so you've got literally nothing to lose. Speaking of Lily, are you going to come say bye? Come say bye to your friends. Because we all know they came to see you, Princess Lily. Eh? Do you have anything to add? Really? Thank you so much for hanging out with me and Lily today. It means the absolute world to us. We hope you have a wonderful week, and we will be counting down the hours until we see you in the next one. Bye.